strength.
Tell
somebody he loves me. Tell him Jesus loves you. Amen. We're going to go into the message today. It's going to be the part two of the two most important things in life. The two most important things in life. Now, in part one, we're able to go through some issues that I discussed. But before we go in depth into this message, I want to start with this verse of the Bible. Proverbs chapter 9 verse 12. Proverbs chapter 9 verse 12. If you are wise, it is to your own advantage. And if you are arrogant, you alone shall bear it. When the word of God is coming to us, if we can humble our heart and allow the word to come to us directly and make total change in us, it's wisdom and it's to our advantage. If you yield to instructions, if you yield to counseling, it's to your advantage. And if you are arrogant, proud, you alone will bear it. So as you listen to this message, part two of the most important things, the two most important things in life, please, don't allow pride to take up your heart. Listen carefully and follow the instructions. This is to your advantage. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. Whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. I told you the two most important things in life has to do with one, loving God, and two, loving your neighbors. You remember last week? The first thing is to love God. The second one is to love your neighbors. Those are the two most important things in life. But do you know that when we have just read, the Bible clearly explained to us that the God of this world, Satan, has blinded the heart of people not to listen to things that matter, not to listen to things that are important in life. It is the scheme of the enemy, it's the scheme of Satan to cover your heart, to make sure that you will not yield to God's instruction, to make sure that you will not yield to God's understanding, to God's word. Sometimes we allow people to hear the word, but we not allow them to apply the words into their lives. It is the scheme of Satan. 2 Corinthians 4:4. Whose minds the God of this age has blinded. So many people are applying the way of destruction these days, honestly speaking. So many people. The way to God is so narrow. Only a few people are walking on this way. Because the God of this age has blinded their heart so they will not believe. Lest the light of the gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. When there is a light in a place, darkness will disappear. Darkness will disappear. If there is a light, darkness, there will be no iota of darkness where there is light. You cannot see darkness where there is light. So the devil knows this, and he has blinded the heart of people not to listen. So you see, in those days, I'm just going to prayer. In those days, I remember when we were growing up in those days. When you go to church, or if you were a student, you were in the student union, or maybe Christian union, they called us, see you. You know, see you. Christian union. Sometimes they say, see you. Evangelical Christian union. They give you a kind of tag that you are the one, you take it to the extreme. Don't like to do those things, they do this and this, and it's not so popular. They know you directly if you are the type in those days. And the gospel so spread so much that people have that desire to serve God. But we are now in a very, where the last days, greatest time has come. These days, people lay emphasis on entertainment. They lay emphasis. If you go to so many places now called church, it's like a stadium, sporting arena. Entertainment, people sing and praise and praise and praise, and little word is coming out. And the word that will be coming out are the word that will make you rich quick. The most popular sermon that the youth like to listen to these days, and all these sermons of calling of holiness, or no, they want the sermon that is so popular among people, mostly youths, is the sermon to get rich quick. If you make your topic to get rich quick, people are ready to listen to this, to the what you can do so you can get rich quick. It is the God of this life that lighted the heart of people not to listen to things that matter. The most important thing is to love God, and the second to love your neighbors. And listen, look at the scriptures with me. Look at the scriptures with me. If you check the scripture very carefully, if you check Hebrews chapter 10, verse 36, it says, "For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise." There's a need to be patient in this life to get anything that you are asking God to do. But these days, people don't want to be patient. You know, there are two tactics. I was discussing with my wife, we were just discussing about the tactics people use these days. In developing countries, or the so-called third world, what they use is kind of magic. That's what they use. If you can play magician, you are a pastor, you can play magician, just do demonstrate one. Next, just get one kind of either food or so, you start to flood the place. In the developed country, you know what they use? Psychology. Psychology. Don't worry, go get it, you can get it, feel good, feel nice, enjoy yourself, life is this. Psychology. They never tell you holiness, they never tell you sin, they never preach on things that are so important to you. When we say get rich quick, and feel good, enjoy yourself, live your life to the... Yes, you got to live your life to the best. God wants to live your life to the best. Nothing is wrong about that. But the Bible tells me, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That all these other things shall be added. But people just want to pursue things that will be added instead of pursuing first the kingdom of God. Share the scripture with me. Luke chapter 12, verse 15. Luke chapter 12, verse 15. Jesus was talking. If you see the sermon, we follow Jesus, right? When Jesus was here, Jesus placed emphasis on the kingdom. Emphasis. How many preachers today are playing emphasis on the kingdom? How many preachers? Playing emphasis on the kingdom. People are playing emphasis on wealth, and I don't know where you're going to go with this word. Look at what Jesus said there in Matthew chapter, in Luke chapter 12, verse 15. Said, "And he said to them, take heed and beware of covetousness. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of the things he possesses." Be careful. Your life does not consist on the abundance of what you possess. God wants you to love him. If you allow all those things that you possess to take over, you will find it difficult to love God. As a matter of fact, you will find it difficult to love your neighbors. So the two most important things in life, one, love God, two, love your neighbors. These are just preambles. We're going to part two. Seriously, very soon. Amen? Are you with me? So what are those things in life that will make people not to just listen? It's just the enemy. Putting what are not important first. Making people to pursue things that are not necessary. 1 Timothy chapter 6 from verse 6 to 11. 1 Timothy chapter 6 from verse 6 to 11 says, "But godliness with contentment is great gain." Godliness with contentment. "For we brought nothing into this world, and we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that." Those who want to get rich fall into the temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. The most important sermon these days is to get rich quick. Hello?
Hi.
Can I preach it?
Yes, sir.
There's nothing wrong to have money, okay? When you preach the sermon to get rich, you see people say, "Hey, yeah, tell us, Pastor, what to get? Come on, tell us. Yeah, your dream is here, you get it right now. Come on, move, baby. You get that money, yeah, you go to write your jet right now. Come on, do it right now." Hey, and people will find every way and they pursue this as if it's the head of it all. Then after you get that one, what next? Life that can evaporate in a second. The two most important things in life, one, you want to love God. You want also love your neighbors. These two things will determine where you will spend your eternity. We are discussing it. We're going to get there. These two things, what to do with Jesus Christ, how you treat Jesus Christ, will determine where you will spend your eternity. And very carefully, how you attend to God's business, how you attend to God's instruction, your service to God, will determine what you will do or what you will have in His kingdom if you get there. Some will get to the kingdom like passing through fire. It's better than not getting there. That was explained in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, I mean chapter 3, from verse 10. We're going to get there. Some will get to the kingdom like passing through fire. Because what you do with what you have with Christ will determine what you will have at the end. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
I know you've been paying attention. You know, some people have God and His words in their mind, but not their heart. You know that kind of people? They have these words, they have God in their mind, but it's not in their heart. God wants to have it in His heart. If you have God in your heart, you will find it easier to understand what I'm telling you right now, and you have the desire to do all that you are hearing. Because to be the doer of the word is the most important thing also. Because those that will do the work will be justified in the end. So let me ask you this question I have here. So, brethren, aspire to put God first in your life. Aspire to do what God wants you to do. Aspire to put into action all that you are listening. It's very important. Have the desire to do God's will. Have the desire to love God. Have the desire to love people. Yeah, it's going to be difficult for you to love God if you don't love people. Do you understand?
Yes.
The demonstration and the practice on how to love God is to love people. You're going to get there as we go into this message. But now this is the question. Why is it that loving God and loving people are the most important things in life? Why? Why did I come up with this one? Now I check everything, I check into life, examine life, and I discover that the two most important things in life one, you love God. Two, you love your neighbors. And Jesus placed emphasis on this. We'll get there as we continue this message. Nothing is as important as this one. Nothing. As important as this one. And we're going to get there at this one. I'm asking you this question now. Why is it that loving God and loving people are the most important things in life? Because these two determine your head, either you like it or not. These two determine your head. These two things determine your head. Either you like it, either you want it or not. It will decide on what God will do with you. Loving God and loving your neighbors. And why loving your neighbors is very important is just because you will not be able to love God. In fact, you cannot love God without loving somebody. We get there in the world as we go. Are you with me today?
Yes, sir.
Jesus used the example of a child to explain this one. We had a little bit of it in part one. In Matthew chapter 18, at that time the disciple came to Jesus saying, "Who then is greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" Then Jesus called a little child to him, set him in the midst of them, and said, "As surely I say to you, unless you are converted and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." Whoever receives one little child like this in my name receives me. Now, Jesus set this child in front to use this child as an example. For you to understand loving God and loving your neighbors, understand how a child attends to life. How children love each other. Understand it. Children, if they are here now, they are fighting. Just now they are fighting. See them maybe beating each other. If you are still available, you are around in a very few time, not too long ago, you see them playing together again. Hello? You see them playing together again. If you explain to them things about God, they get it fast, they understand faster. You explain to them, you take them, you say, do this, they will not argue with you. You bring your children to the church, they will not tell you, Father, money, I'm not going. They follow. I'm talking of children now. Are you with me? They follow you, they obey you. Whatever you ask them to do, they want to do. As much as they can understand. Children, they forgive easily. Children, they love easily. Children. And that is why it is easy for people to take advantage of them. That is why you have to tell your children not to be so much attracted to strangers. Because if a child sees a stranger, say, hey, come, 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 come. Child will follow. Some children will just go to strangers. And before you know it, children can say, come. Because they believe everything. And you ask a child a question. If you didn't tutor that child to lie, you ask the child this question, the child will just say the truth right there. In fact, don't just listen. They listen to children that listen to adults. They will tell you the whole story. Everything, they will never hide it. Everything that happens, they will just tell you, mommy did it. Daddy did this. They will not hide it at all. You know, suddenly they will speak. And you tell them, why are you saying this? They laugh. So Jesus used a child as an example that not the issue of being great, being the greatest in the heaven, but it's the issue of you getting to the kingdom. You will not get to the kingdom except you be like this child, which means you will love as this child loves, as this child loves. You will attend to life as she or he attends to life. You will forgive as this child forgives. You will treat people as this child will treat people. Do you understand what I'm talking about now? Children don't understand how to manipulate. When a child begins to understand how to manipulate, it's no longer a child. How to manipulate? It's no longer a child. So Jesus wants you to be like a child so you can enter the kingdom. Are you with me? First, your relationship with God, you love God. The first most important thing. The second, you love your neighbor. Check the scripture with me. Proverbs chapter 8. Proverbs 8 verse 36. Do you know why you have to love God? And why you have to love your neighbors? That is what's going to determine your end. That's what's going to determine my end. Where I will spend my eternity depends on me loving God and embracing my neighbors. Verse 36 of Proverbs 8. For those who fail to find me harm themselves. When you fail to find God, you are harming yourself. You are not doing yourself any good to run away from God. The more you are far away from God, the closer you are to destruction, to Titanic. The more you are far away from God, the closer you are to destruction. The closer you are to God, the closer you are to your destiny, to a place of peace. He said, all who hate me love death. Are you here? If you hate God, you love death. I've had people say so many things in the social media, especially Facebook. Some people ignorantly, they will talk about Jesus Christ, they will trash him. One man was talking the other time, he was talking about Jesus, he was trashing Jesus, he was talking about politicians, he was comparing Jesus Christ with politicians in Africa, in Nigeria. Can you imagine somebody comparing Jesus to politicians in Nigeria? Those who are greedy, those who are ready to do anything for the sake of acquiring wealth. Is Jesus like that?
No.
This is how people talk. But the end will judge who is right. Because at the end, you will have to do with him. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. You cannot get to God except through Jesus Christ. You cannot have eternal rest except you have given your life to Jesus Christ. It's the basic. You cannot change it. No matter what you want, whatever you believe, Jesus Christ is the only way. Those of you who are fresh to that man, I know some of you, at least somebody was passing comment on that statement that man made. Go tell him that the pastor said, the only way to heaven is Jesus Christ. And if he, I pray that he will give his life to Christ before it is too late. Before it is too late. We all come to that point in our lives when we know that Christ is the way. But the issue is that it might be too late to some people. He's the only way. Look at 1 John chapter 4, verse 8. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. If you hate people, you don't know God. Don't deceive yourself. Some of us, we are so hypocritical. God is my friend. I love God. And you hate your neighbor. How can you love God and you hate your neighbor? Some of us, we just, it's this talk. Some of us, we can fly plane from here to anywhere. Whereas we have never gone to flight school. You press it like this, you cruise it, you put it on computer. And you have never been to flight school. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Your relationship with others are very important. Look at 1 John 4 from verse 19. 1 John 4 from verse 19. Hey, brethren, you know, I know that preaching, you may think, shouldn't be teaching. But preaching is teaching. If I'm speaking, I don't take you to the Bible, you may think I'm just talking from my head, offhand. So when I take you to the scriptures, I'm just trying to prove to you that what I'm telling you is recorded in the scriptures and is the word of God. It's not my word. 1 John 4 from verse 19. We love because he first loved us, right? I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. I am a friend of God. Because what? He calls me friend. He first loved us. Don't let me speak that word. He first did what? He first loves us. That's why we love him. And he said, if anyone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. Do you listen now? So two things will determine in your hand. First, love to God, and second, love to your neighbors. It is very, very impossible for you to love God if you don't love your neighbor. Are you here with me? It is absolutely impossible for you to say you love God when you don't love your neighbor. We're going to get there. Then we permit to explain to you. Okay? For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. Are you listening to me now?
Yes, sir.
Shall we? Please look at me. Don't look anybody. Don't look at anybody else. I'm watching out what is going on. They say back home, they said, it's on the face that you find discussion. And that is Yoruba English. That is what they try to explain, that when I'm talking to you, you look at me face to face. So that I can know that you are doing what? Eh? Thank you. Eye contact. Verse 21. And this commandment we have from him, whoever loves God must also love his brother. 1 John 4 from verse 19 to 21. So now, if you come to me and tell me, oh, I love my brother, oh, I love my neighbor, oh, I love my sister, oh, I love my wife, I love my husband, and you don't show that love genuinely, it's going to be very difficult. If it is a fake love, then it means that the love you have to God is fake. If love you have for your neighbor is original, it means that the love you have to God is what? Original. If the love you have to your neighbor is genuine, it means that the love you have to God is genuine. You cannot love God if you don't love your neighbor. So those of you who hate people, it's dangerous. No matter the color of their skin, no matter the way they speak, no matter the way they walk, no matter the way they look, you hate anybody, you don't love God. Because God is love. God is not, does not hate anybody. Nothing is as important as your relationship with God and where you will spend your eternity. So important. Your relationship with God is so important. Your eternity will depend on that. I put down some facts that we will see, but I don't know if time will permit us to go through this fact. You know, God keeps record of us, what we do. He keeps record of everything that we do. How you treat God, how you treat your neighbors, is recorded. God is taking record of everything. Don't think that God is not doing it. Some of us will be saying that billions of people in this world can't do that. God does it. Do you know? Okay. Do you know human beings, those people that are human beings, do you know what internet is doing right now? Think about the traffic on the internet, the traffic, how many people are communicating on the internet per second, the traffic on the internet, people that are sending email at the same time. Look at your phone. Look at how many calls that are going in and out, how much your phone will be doing, how much pressure you are giving. We don't even know the effect of this on our body. We don't know yet. The scientists have not come to, they have not finished that research. They are still thinking, what effect do we think phone we have on the cell phone, especially nobody with that cell phone, almost everybody with that. Hey, my little one, 7 years old, little one, came to me and she said, "Daddy, get me my cell phone." I said, "What?" She said, "My friend has one." "Your friend has cell phone?" Say, "Yeah, my friend has." "Your friend, if your friend has cell phone, does not you have, what are you going to use cell phone for? You are still a kid. We carry you here and there, put you here and say, buy me one, Daddy." The other time to surprise me, she came to me, she said, "Daddy, buy me an iPad." He said, "Yeah, Daddy." He said, "iPad 1 is very cheap. You can get that one. iPad 2 is not too expensive. No, but iPad 3 is more expensive." Where do you get all this information? She said, "I talk with my friends." Honestly speaking, a 7 year old. Talking about iPad like adult. So if human beings can put all those electronics together and they are functioning very well, people send email from anywhere, the world is so close now. Very soon, let me tell you, postal services, very soon we have more problems than they are having now. Yes. Nobody is sending email. I mean, nobody is sending letters now. In those days, you know, our mothers will call us, "Write for me, my son, how are you doing?" We'll be writing, "I like you, send me a letter, this and that," and we'll mail it. These days, they don't do that. What you just tell your son or your daughter, go open an email account. You are talking. In fact, some people, they Skype. As we talk, we see each other. Things are, I mean, the way things are going on, if human beings can do that, are you telling me that God is not going to do that? He's taking effort of everything about you. And listen to me very carefully, you will be rewarded accordingly. If you are listening to this and you are doing it, it's for your good. If you ignore and say, "Oh, don't just talk anything, you like, Pastor, let's go," it's for your good. I put down so many things to back that up. Maybe if you can have another part, we'll be able to explain that one. I want to go straight to the issue of explaining the fact that we need to love God, we need to love our neighbors also. There was a discussion Jesus Christ brought up. Before I just explain this discussion, then maybe possibly we'll pray and then we'll go home. You know, when Jesus said this thing, last week I brought up, I think Matthew chapter 22, where we read these stories. But Luke gave an account. And the account of Luke, the account of Matthew in Matthew chapter 22, a little bit different from the account of Luke. I want to examine this one quickly so we can pray. If you can have opportunity of having part 3, I may explain to you some other benefits, some facts on the part of you loving God and you loving your neighbors. You never lose. Do you listen to me now?
Yes, sir.
If you can do what I'm saying, you will never lose. If you can love God and love your neighbors, you will never lose. The only time you lose is for you to hate somebody. You hate somebody, you will give account of this to God, and it's a great loss. It is better you have not been born, because God is small. So, one expert in the law came to Jesus Christ. And when he came to Jesus Christ, he asked him a question. Matthew in Luke chapter 10. Let's think about that. Let's discuss that. And then we are ready to go home. Amen?
Amen.
In Matthew chapter 10 from verse 25. Luke chapter 10 from verse 25. Luke chapter 10. It means you are following me. That is good. I love that. Verse 25. On one occasion, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus. "Teacher," he asked. You know, when you first want to try somebody, you first praise that person. You first praise Jesus. "Teacher." Another person called him Rabbi. Just like, "Hey, you, I know you. I give you one. You are the great teacher." Just praising, What he was trying to do is to make him fall. You understand? But he's trying to praise him first. What will I do? What must I do to inherit eternal life? Now, this is an expert. He was an expert in law. He was a lawyer, an expert. Not just a lawyer, but an expert, a senior advocate, a guru in law. Verse 26. And Jesus asked him, because Jesus knew he was a lawyer, say, what is written in the law? He replied, how do you read it? He answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. That's what is written in the law, right? And verse 28, you have answered correctly. Jesus replied, do this and you will live. Just do this one and you will live. Okay, verse 29. But he wanted to justify himself. So he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Who now is my neighbor? He did not say, who is God? What did he say? Now, some of us, we think that we know God, but we don't know God. Now, this expert in law is pretending to know God. He doesn't know God. He thought that what I need to know is, he was trying to find a way to make Jesus fall. So he said, now who is my neighbor? Who is now my neighbor? You say, love my neighbor. And then you can have the same question. Jesus, in the same pastor, you have to say, the two most important things in that is, one, to love God. And he said, second thing is to love my neighbor like myself. Now, I understand, you can say, I understand to love God. But sometimes we don't even understand to love God. Because if you don't understand to love your neighbor, you cannot understand to love God. Now, he may ask this question just to test Jesus Christ, he said. If you go to verse 30, he said, in reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he was attacked by robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. Why did Jesus use priest? Because he's supposed to know better. This is a pastor. Saw the man, he did what? Somebody who knows God, somebody was preaching, saying, love your neighbor like yourself. Like I'm teaching now. I'm just teaching you, saying, love your neighbor like myself, and I saw somebody who was half dead, and I passed by. That's what this place is saying. Verse 32. So to a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him pass by on the other side. A Levite. Who is a Levite? This a Jew. Somebody who knows praise. Somebody who serves. Somebody who knows the best thing to do. Close to a priest. Somebody who works with the priest. Hello? He also looked at the other side pass. Just like we are talking about the choir director, choir mistress, deaconesses, elders in the church. So we are talking about people in the church now. When you talk of priests, you talk of Levite, people in the synagogue. Okay? For people that are supposed to know the law. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, a Samaritan, you know Samaritan and the Jews? Samaritan, they are like Gentiles, they are like non-entity, they are like rule out. They are like, they don't know about God. They don't understand anything about God. They are not close to God. They are not. They don't have any promise from God. They don't. God doesn't love them. Hello? They have no covenant with God. They have no destiny. People that look down on Samaritans. Remember the woman, the Samaritan woman was talking to Jesus Christ. Why are you talking to me, Samaritan? You are a Jew. And he went. So you understand what I'm talking about. So, but this Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him, he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out two denarii and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers? Verse 37, the expert in the law replied, the one who had mercy on him. Jesus told him, go and do likewise. I want these three people, priest, Levite, Samaritan. Who is the best? hey, judgment will begin in the house of God. Because to whom much is given, much is expected. People that you think you know, my Bible tells me there's a way that's made right to man, but the end is destruction. Don't say, I know everything. I am in the church. I was born in the church. That is not what we are saying. The thing I'm asking is that, are you doing what we are hearing? Do you listen to instruction? Don't say, you don't know my title. I am the pastor. Don't you know I'm a deacon? Don't you know I'm a deaconess? Don't you know that I'm elder in the church? Don't you know that I have been to Bible college? Don't you know this? That is not what we are saying. All these things, they will help you to get the word. But these are not the criteria to get to the kingdom of God. You must love God first, seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. All these things are added. And you must love your neighbor like yourself. They are two most important things that will determine where you will spend your eternity. What was the question of this expert? What was his question? What brought about this parable? Eh? No. What was the first question he asked Jesus Christ? Yeah. How can I get to the kingdom of God? How can I enter there? That was the first. That was the first thing that started these things. And Jesus asked him, "You are the expert in law. What does the law say?" And he says, the Lord says, you love God with all your heart, with all your mind. And the second is that the boss will love your neighbor like yourself. And he says, okay, go and do it. Then he asked Jesus, who is my neighbor? And Jesus gave him this parable. Three kind of people passed by this man that was wounded on the street. A priest, who's supposed to know better. A Levite, who's supposed to know better. And a handyman, right-hand man of a priest. And now a Samaritan. But the one who did better was Samaritan. Think about your life. Don't think that you know all. Think about your life. Do you love God? I want to conclude by going back to that Proverbs chapter 9. Proverbs 9 verse 12. If you are wise, it is to your own advantage. And if you are arrogant, you alone shall bear it. If all we are hearing, you think there is a way you need to make adjustment, please make adjustment. The issue of the kingdom is an issue of 911. It's emergency. Don't joke with it. Just today, one of you asked questions because he lost one of his friends. That his friend that died, he didn't know he was going to die. He slept, he woke up, he was in his car, he was driving in his car, cruising his car. Which means he had his legs, he had his hand, his head was correct. But the car just broke down. He came out of the car, semi hit him, boom. He died. That will not be your head in Jesus' name. Amen. For the issue of the kingdom, there is no repentance in grave. If you see hate somebody, will you please repent? If you don't love God, will you please repent and love God? Hate can come at any time. If you have been talking trash about Jesus Christ, will you please give your life to Jesus Christ today?
Yes.
Because tomorrow might be too late. Today is the day of salvation. God bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The two most important things in life, you want to love God and you love your neighbor. You cannot love God without loving your neighbor. When anyone says he hates his brother and says he loves God, he's a liar. Father, we bless you this afternoon. We honor you for your mercy. Bless you for this wonderful time we had together this afternoon. Thank you for the word that has come out. We pray, Lord, that this word that came out will do us good, not bad, in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
This word, this message will not stand against us in the last day when we will ask us to give account of our lives to you. Thank you, precious Holy Spirit. Help us to love you. Help us to love our neighbors. Blessed be your name, God. And if you can do this, then we can fulfill the law. In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Amen.